I believe in the power of the imagination to remake the world, to hold back the night, to charm motorways, to ingratiate ourselves with birds, to enlist the confidences of madmen. I believe in my own obsessions, in the beauty of the car crash, in the peace of the submerged forest, in the excitements of the deserted holiday beach, in the elegance of automobile graveyards, in the mystery of multi-story car parks, in the poetry of abandoned hotels.
Over a career spanning 50 years, J.G. Ballard has proved himself to be one of this country's most thought-provoking writers. He enjoyed great mainstream success with Empire of the Sun, which Steven Spielberg later turned into a hit film. But it's also caused huge controversy, particularly with Crash, which examined the sexual potential of car crashes and inspired one publisher's reader to write, "This author is beyond psychiatric help. Do not publish." And in the space between these two vastly different novels, Ballard has created a distinctive fictional territory wholly his own. Prophetic, surreal and unsettling, Ballard's 20 novels and hundreds of short stories have together constructed what their author calls a mythology of the future. His body of work is marked by recurrent themes and obsessive symbols: motorways, car parks, high-rises, business parks and abandoned hotels. Ballard's latest novel, Kingdom Come, returns to one of his obsessive themes: the dark forces at work in the suburbs of Middle England. In Claire Holland's South Bankshire film, from his lookout in the London suburb of Shepperton, where he's lived for over 40 years, J.G. Ballard talks about his vision of what he calls the only alien planet, Earth, and tells us why science fiction was the true literature of the 20th century.
I was living in London and looking for somewhere to live with my wife and children, and the sort of London suburbs were a sort of vast, mysterious plain of bricky gables and dual carriageways. The one place that I spotted, where there was a little house that was for sale, was Shepperton, and I had a vague feeling. The film studios, yes, the Malibu of the Thames Valley. And I thought, well, you know, there's a dimension of possibility there.
Melvin, pleasure to meet you.
Very good to meet you.
You look well.
It's
incredible.
Good to see you at last. Yeah. In your favourite aircraft.
I like it. It's great. I could rent it. I'd happily move in.
Ah. So if we get set up, we'll get moving on. You were brought up, as it were, in Shanghai. Many people watching this will know the film Empire of the Sun if they haven't read the book or know both. But in your terms, can you give us some idea of what you now feel, looking back, it was like to be brought up in Shanghai?
My parents were both English. My father and mother went out there in 1929. I was born there in 1930. I have very strong memories of this exciting, in some ways frightening city, where, as a child of one of the Western powers who ran the city, I had a sort of passport to safety at all times. I mean, I used to get on my bike at the age of 7 or 8 and pedal off through downtown Shanghai in all that sort of nightmare traffic. And this was a city plagued by terrorist bombs and bitter fighting between rival Chinese power groups. Then in 1937, the Japanese invaded China.
Shanghai is doomed. Panic seizes the population. Fear drives thousands in a desperate move to the safety of the international settlement.
War was all around us. Shells were passing over our house. So we moved to the French concession for about 6 months. Looking back, I think I saw it as part of a sort of film, almost. The kind of films that I saw, even as a very small boy, in the Shanghai theatres, had sort of leaked out into reality and were taking place at the end of my own street.
But one thing that intrigues me about what you've said there is this extraordinary charmed life you had, Jim. You were this English boy, you got on your bike, your English bike, and cycled through these very dangerous parts, and people left you alone.
I don't think my parents were aware of what I was doing. I once asked my mother, when she was a very old woman, sort of, you know, I used to ride my bicycle around Shanghai. She said, we didn't know. I think the reason was that the retaliation from the Shanghai police force, which was run by the British, would have been swift and brutal. so you tended to be left alone. All that changed very dramatically after Pearl Harbor, when Japan attacked America and Britain. And I suddenly noticed that nobody was treating me with any respect at all. It was get out of the way.
Almost 40 years later, when you went back to the imprint of those times to write Empire of the Sun, which became an extremely successful book and extremely successful film, had you been wanting to write it during those 40 years?
I think when I came to England in 1946, I soon realised that I was going to spend the rest of my life here, effectively. So I thought, there's no point in trying to remember Shanghai and my life there. It's gone. Forget it. The trouble was that Shanghai kept coming back.
Bodies of Chinese lay everywhere, hands tied behind their backs in the centre of the road, dumped behind the sandbag emplacements, half-severed heads resting on each other's shoulders. The thousands of young gangsters in their American suits had gone, but at the Bubbling Well Road checkpoint, Jim saw one youth in a blue silk suit being beaten by two soldiers with staves. As the blows struck his head, he knelt in a pool of blood that dripped from his lapels.
Empire of the Sun, published in 1984, presents a fictionalized account of Ballard's childhood in occupied Shanghai, revisiting the unsettling and distinctive landscapes which define his fiction. Did you deliberately omit certain things to make it dramatically more effective, or did it just evolve the way it did without you making those sort of conscious decisions?
No, I had to leave a lot of things out. It was impossible to compress 4 to 5 years of life, particularly when so much was happening. Most of the novel is set in the Japanese camp where I was interned with my parents. The biggest change I made was to leave my parents out. I made the boy, my younger self in effect, Jim, a kind of war orphan. I had him separated from his parents. A certain sort of estrangement took place during the camp years between me and my parents. And, you know, they couldn't feed me, clothe me, protect me.
I've got some.
Also, I saw them shaken and rattled by the war. For a child these days to see its parents frightened is very rare. And when you've seen your parents sort of lose their authority, it's something they never regain, I think. So leaving them out was truer psychologically to my actual experiences.
His childhood and adolescence was marked by this absolutely profound dislocation of reality. You look at something like the killing of the young Chinese man by the four Japanese soldiers on the abandoned railway station where the man is asphyxiated by a telephone wire in front of his face, you know, a quintessential and horrific Ballard image. But, I mean, this really happened to him. He really was that boy. He really did see that happen.
Human beings are extremely cruel and combative. I think my life in Shanghai in the 30s and 40s was much closer to the reality of this world than, say, living in the cosy suburbs of the west of London. I don't feel that Shanghai was such a bad preparation for living in our time.
When you came here, you decided to study medicine. What made you go in that direction?
I think I thought, if I become a psychiatrist, my first patient will be me. I will find out what's wrong. I'm not sure there was anything wrong, but I just carried too much of a burden from the past. To become a psychiatrist then, you know, in 1950, you needed a medical degree. And I thoroughly enjoyed the 2 years I spent as a medical student, particularly the anatomy, dissecting cadavers. You spend hours each day minutely paring away the skin and muscles and nerves, carrying out this extremely detailed examination of what was once a human being with a heart, with love affairs, triumphs, disappointments. By the time you've completed the dissection of the head in particular, you have explored a great Amazon of sort of human possibilities and human experience. It was a marvelous education. I think everyone should study medicine, should study anatomy anyway.
Why did you drop out of medicine and join the RAF?
I was already writing short stories and, you know, I sort of told myself I was already a novelist. I'd written sort of 20 pages, and when you are a novice, as you know, when you're first setting out, 20 pages of a novel when you're 19 seems like Finnegan's Wake. So I thought, I'll take my chances. Then I had a number of jobs. Then I thought, I'll try flying. So I spent about a year in the RAF, or the Royal Canadian Air Force, actually. But I still had to make another break and embark on what was quite a difficult set of obstacles to cross, becoming a published writer. Not easy.
How and why did you decide to write science fiction?
What England needed, I felt, in the mid-50s, desperately, was change. It seemed so stuck in its ways. Its social conventions and its class system were all set in concrete. And when I discovered, by chance, science fiction, I thought, here's a literature which has terrific vitality and is about change. I wasn't interested in spaceships and time travel. I thought, this is a medium where I can put to use my interest in social change. You know, the American way of life, the consumer society, television, which was going to dominate everything. First jet travel, motorways. I mean, we take them for granted now, but motorways provoked all sorts of worried letters to the Times newspaper when the M1 was opened. Are we going to Americanize our country? Do we want a deracinated people endlessly driving their cars up and down the land? And I thought, what? This is a motorway, for heaven's sake. It was important to write about change, and science fiction was a very good way. Also, I had a flair for it. You could write an unlimited number of short stories. You could write 10 a month and get them published if you wrote that many. That was quite something.
It's a genre for swats, really, science fiction. It's a nerdy genre, and he isn't at all like that. He has a sort of a grandness that you don't often find in this sort of chemistry lab kind of mind that the lesser writers are like that. But I wouldn't be as embarrassed as some people are by the label science fiction. I think it's produced many works of great genius, but nor would I dream of confining him to that genre either.
Since the introduction of the 24-hour spending day, the shopping complex was never closed. The bulk of the shoppers were discount buyers, housewives contracted to make huge volume purchases of food, clothing and appliances against substantial overall price cuts, and forced to drive around all day from supermarket to supermarket, frantically trying to keep pace with their purchase schedules and grappling with the added incentives inserted to keep the schemes alive.
What he correctly identified was the point in which humankind quite rightly began to lose its faith in the scientific notion that technology was going to deliver us from universal want and need and bring a bright new shiny future of jetpacks and dinner and a pill. He kind of spotted that very early on. And I think his work, therefore, was part of what made it possible to redefine science fiction as a genre, but arguably redefine it out of being science fiction.
You also are firmly of the opinion that science fiction is the true and best way to write about the situation in which we find ourselves.
I thought science fiction was the literature of the 20th century. I think science fiction has played back the 20th century to itself in a way that the mainstream novel doesn't. If you think of the Hampstead novel, it describes a very small social class engaged in sort of very small sort of location dances of bees are about as expressive as the most Hampstead novels. And the great thing about science fiction was that nobody lives in Hampstead. I believe in the genital organs of great men and women, in the postures of President Kennedy, Margaret Thatcher, and Princess Di, and the sweet odors emanating from their lips as they regard the cameras of the world. I believe in madness, in the truth of the inexplicable, in the common sense of stones, in the lunacy of flowers. I believe in nothing.
Your first novel, The Drowned World, 1962, that imagined a future where there's been a great ecological catastrophe, polar ice caps melting. This is way before everybody worried about polar ice caps melting and so on. Did you write The Drowned World to a prescription? What if this would happen? Had you intimations of melting polar ice caps?
I was very under the influence of the surrealists at that time. I think that's partly because war produces very surrealist effects. The bus on top of a block of flats after a bombing raid or five-story building collapses and we can see all the individual homes with their furniture still in place. Strange effects like that. I love the paintings of Max Ernst, deep jungles, which seem like the unconscious mind exposed to daylight or to this strange half-light that you find in surrealist paintings. They seem to be painting states of mind, which I was interested in doing, because The Drowned World is also an attempt to sort of plunge down into the spinal column and descend into a more primeval world where we'll find our true selves, perhaps.
One of the themes of surrealist painting was a sort of sense of ecological disaster or ecological dread. You think of temperatures where clocks melt and these kind of petrified forests. It looks as though it could have been a cover from one of his early books. The early stories were all kind of full of the same sense of ecological dread and disaster, kind of drowned worlds, vermilion sands, crystal world. The kind of post-apocalyptic landscape that was very much a feature of the atomic age.
In the early morning light, a strange, mournful beauty hung over the lagoon. The somber green-black fronds of the gymnosperms, intruders from the Triassic past and the half-submerged, white-faced buildings of the 20th century, still reflected together in the dark mirror of the water. The two interlocking worlds apparently suspended at some junction in time.
So you're talking about mindscapes as well as landscapes, aren't you?
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, these are novels of catastrophe, the early ones, of natural catastrophes, polar ice caps melting and so on. But then I started looking at what I think of as an urban catastrophe. And I started, because by the end of the 60s, a lot of the kind of social contradictions that weren't so evident when we were all enjoying swinging London, those of us who could find a babysitter, a lot of the contradictions were coming out into the open. And I thought, you know, there was a kind of culture of sensation that I think was ignited by the Kennedy assassination and the way that was endlessly replayed on television. I thought, this is strange, because everything, there's a sort of devaluation of human sympathy going on here. We're sort of brutalizing ourselves in this endless quest for, you know, for excitement and sensation.
Another massive effect on your life, which you needn't talk about but just record, is that your wife died very suddenly, leaving you with three children to bring up, which you did. That must have had a tremendous effect on your life.
Yes, it did. I mean, it absolutely shattered me. I think it probably changed everything about me, to be honest. I think I was never the same person again. You know, my wife was 34 when she died of pneumonia while we were on holiday in Spain, leaving these three small children. I felt, you know, that nature had committed a terrible crime against this young woman. It took me a long while to accommodate that into some sort of, you know, I started writing a series of strange short fictions that were collected as the Atrocity Exhibition.
It was very unusual at the time for someone to publish a book containing two short stories, one called The Facelift of Princess Margaret and the other called Why I Want to Fuck Ronald Reagan. You know, that would be unusual at any time, perhaps.
The central character is a psychiatrist who's having a mental breakdown. He's obsessed with the amount of cruelty and pure sensation for its own sake that floods the world, floods TV screens and films and so on. He sets out on a sort of strange little odyssey of his own in which he restages some of the most terrible events of his time, the Kennedy assassination, for example.
Oswald was the starter. From his window above the track, he opened the race by firing the starting gun. It is believed that the first shot was not properly heard by all the drivers. In the following confusion, Oswald fired the gun two more times, but the race was already underway. Kennedy got off to a bad start. There was a governor in his car, and its speed remained constant at about 15 miles an hour. However, shortly afterwards, when the governor had been put out of action, the car accelerated rapidly and continued at high speed along the remainder of the course.
I think it was all an attempt to make, you know, two and two make five. And if two and two could make five, then somehow my wife's death could be explained. It couldn't. I'd seen enough during my childhood to know death comes without any sort of calling card, just comes suddenly. And it's probably meaningless. But it takes a long time to learn that.
Can you tell us about the form of that book?
You could call it experimental, but some people might say that all it proves is that the experiment hasn't worked. The problem is that people tackle the book as if it was a conventional sort of linear narrative running page one onwards, and it isn't. I wanted something that reflected the texture of everyday life in the 60s. There was this sense that we were living entirely in a media landscape. It was very difficult to tell what was real and what was false. And I wanted to convey something of the feeling of what it was like to be bombarded from all sides. And particularly if you were having a nervous breakdown, you might well see the world as it's shown in the Atrocity Exhibition. The thing to do is don't start reading page one and start at random, anywhere. If you find a paragraph that intrigues you, read it. It'll probably set up resonances in your mind. Move on and look at the adjacent paragraphs. Soon, it'll begin to assemble a portrait of something probably close to everyday reality.
Crash made its appearance in the Atrocity Exhibition. 3 years later, you wrote what still could be thought of as your most controversial novel, Crash. And I can't resist quoting one publisher's reader who said, "This author who is beyond psychiatric help, do not publish." Well, it was published, and it's republished and republished and republished. Can you tell us what you were doing in that and the way that the technology and the idea of the eroticism of the car crash drove through the book in a way that disturbed people? Do not publish, said this chap.
I took that, by the way, as a huge compliment. Because this publisher's reader was herself the wife of a psychiatrist. And I thought, total artistic success. I think I was obsessed then with the sort of the taste for cruelty and sensation that we saw, you know, particularly in the cinema. Feature films were unbelievably violent then, and at the center of most feature films was the car chase and like a sort of evil flower emerging out of the sort of screaming streets came this, you know, the crashing cars. And nobody, no one seemed in the least put off by the car crash.
Cram the bucket!
It's obvious that the car crash has powerful resonances that, particularly if they involve the death of the famous, that, you know, plane crashes or hotel fires or train crashes don't have.
Why do you think that
is? What is it about the car?
Yes.
Well, I think it's that, of course, we all drive, most of us drive cars. Most of us are aware that if we give in to feelings of aggression, we may kill ourselves. There's a sort of erotic fascination that death has for us when we imagine it. I mean, the connections between sex, eroticism, and death have been explored, you know, for hundreds of years, if not thousands. But it seemed to me that what had once been the sort of morbid playground of a small group of French intellectuals was the standard fare chosen by mass audiences who were going to the movies for the evening. They quite liked it, you know, watching people entangled in car crashes. So I thought, there's probably, you know, there's some sort of connection that needs to be explored.
Vaughan unfolded for me all his obsessions with the mysterious eroticism of wounds, the perverse logic of blood-soaked instrument panels, seatbelts smeared with excrement, sun visors lined with brain tissue. For Vaughan, each crashed car set off a tremor of excitement. In the complex geometries of a dented fender, in the unexpected variations of crushed radiator grills, in the grotesque overhang of an instrument panel forced onto a driver's crotch as if in some calibrated act of machine fellatio.
I wrote sarcastically about crash as a defense because I didn't get it, and it alarmed me, and everyone did too. I mean, everyone wore a different costume to the ball. I wore sarcasm, a lot of people wore moral outrage, etc. I didn't get it.
I wanted people to be shocked and disgusted. I wanted to unsettle the reader. I wanted to expose the perverse side of the reader's mind. I wanted to provoke the reader into facing the possibility that people are excited by violence.
The interesting thing is that 23 years later, when David Cronenberg turned into a film, it was equally controversial. Alexander Walker, then the movie critic of the Evening Standard, said, a movie beyond the bounds of depravity, and it was banned by Westminster City Council.
Still is.
So you'd hit something that the nerve hadn't been anaesthetized, had it?
I went to Cannes with the when it was shown there, taking the line that this film was a sort of deeply moral statement. At this point, Walker stood up and stormed out. But I noticed that the French and Italians, Spaniards who were there, all completely understood what Crash was about. The distinction is between the sort of Catholic countries, which believe in original sin, nowhere, or rather perverse, if we're given half a chance.
They have a death at the center of their religion.
Right. And, say, the Protestant countries of Northern Europe. The film was banned in Norway. It was banned in large sections of this country, in effect, and banned in large sections of America. I think we are still deeply repressed, and there are things we don't like to acknowledge about ourselves.
What I didn't get is that the obsessive love of the car crash is a result of a car crash. The main character, who's called Ballard, has just had a car crash in which someone else, not himself, has died. And he's in a state of shock. And that's what the novel miraculously conveys. I realize, having read it for the third or fourth time, which I did when writing about the Cronenberg film, where I recanted and came round and at last saw what he was trying to do.
Ballard is a highly moral writer who is so moral that he can entertain within the confines of the text total amorality. For Ballard, it's a kind of high wire of ambiguity. The reader can never really tell what's going on here. Are they being told not to drive too fast, or are they being told that they really should drive into the next available concrete stanchion and then masturbate over the smashed instrument binnacle? I mean, and you know what? You're never going to know.
I've often said about my fiction as a whole, you know, I'm not a pessimist, a man who holds a sign up saying, you know, dangerous bends ahead, slow down, is not a pessimist. On the other hand, I sometimes tend to hold up a sign saying dangerous bends ahead, speed up, because I've got a slightly perverse delight in provoking people, you know, just a little too far. I believe in anxiety, psychosis, and despair. I believe in the perversions, in the infatuations with trees, princesses, prime ministers, derelict filling stations, more beautiful than the Taj Mahal, clouds and birds. I believe in the death of the emotions and the triumph of the imagination.
In your fiction, what it seems to me that you're saying is that we used to think, when we said the real world, we used to think it was out there. That was the real world, of people out there doing this, that, and the other. You're now proposing that it's become a fictional world out there, and the reality is now the responsibility of the imagination.
Yes, I mean, I think that to my father's generation, you know, in the 1910s and 1920s, the real world was the world of work, of offices, factories, and the like, and the world of the imagination existed inside one's own head. One's dreams, fears, ambitions. That is now almost reversed. Reality is now a mass of competing fictions. We walk down streets which are lined with advertisements, trying to sell us some fairy tale, such as that this particular detergent will wash your children's clothes to the point where their friends' mothers will envy them. Now, that's a piece of fiction. By the same token, the one area that we can rely on for some sort of truth is the space inside our heads.
In some of your novels, you've almost created laboratories in which to test this theory. One of these is a novel called Supercan. It's set on the Riviera, which you know very well. It can be called a detective novel, it can be called an investigative novel, it can be called a dystopian novel. But what do you think you were setting out to do?
I've been going to the French Riviera, really, since the late 40s, on holiday.
Amen.
It's changed from a playground into a sort of work ground. If you go into the big hotels in Cannes or Nice, you find, you know, the people in the lift with you are brain surgeons attending a conference, Volvo salesmen attending, you know, some big get-together. The whole infrastructure of the place has changed. There are motorways, heliports, science parks that have sprung up. And one of the largest was Sophia Antipolis. It's a huge science park where people live in the residential enclaves within the science park. People there have an odd look in their eyes. It's unmistakable. That's the sort of look you see in the eyes of people on the other side of were looking at you through barbed wire, watchful, dulled, sort of anaesthetized. I thought, what will happen to these people if they stay too long here? Something might be needed to spark these people and give them a sense of achievement and excitement in their lives. And I visualize in Supercan a society of utterly exhausted senior executives who only get their joie de vivre by joining little groups who go out at night and attack immigrant families. And the psychiatrist who runs this therapeutic scheme defends it by saying, you know, this is the future.
I realized that these highly disciplined professionals had very strange dreams, fantasies filled with suppressed yearnings for violence and ugly narratives of anger and revenge, like the starvation dreams of death camp prisoners. Despair was screaming through the bars of the corporate cage, the hunger of men and women exiled from their deeper selves. They wanted more violence in their lives.
We're falling back on our oldest resource, which is on our own psychopathology. It's the one thing that will energize us.
T.S. Eliot famously said, humankind cannot bear too much reality. In a sense, what you're saying in Supercan is humankind cannot bear too much unreality. It's what could be described as an isolated, privileged, perfect, in inverted commas, community. But you extend the metaphor massively. You use the area in which we are now, Shepperton, in your new book, Kingdom Come. You use that as a location which is clearly standing for where everybody's going. Somewhere you say, everywhere is becoming a suburb of Dusseldorf. This book addresses, attacks, attempts to understand, says some things which will surprise a lot of people. In praise of the consumer society, this is where freedom is, this is where the real life is. Can you just disentangle some of the themes in Kingdom Come?
It's set in the West London suburbs, not far from the M25. It's an area that most inner Londoners are unaware of, never visit, pass by in polite horror as they return from their West Country cottages and speed gratefully off the M25 towards what I call heritage London. To them, the sort of area in which I set my novel, Brooklands, is an uncentered area where there are no civic values, where people are only interested in new patio doors, a new timeshare in the Algarve, another car. The sort of pillars that held society together, the monarchy, the Church of England, politics, they've all lost their authority, I think. So what is left? All that is left is consumerism, the consumer society of buy, buy, buy.
He's lived for many years in Shepperton, which he thinks of as being on the edge of the future. And he sees the future as being one of these endless lists of retail parks, marinas, and above all, the grand new project, which is the mega shopping centre, which is the kind of Kublai Khan Xanadu of his fiction. It is a kind of ecclesiastical space of consumerism.
We're facing a new kind of man and woman, narrow-eyed, passive, clutching their store cards. They believe anything that people like you care to tell them. They want to be tricked. They want to be deluded into buying the latest rubbish. They've been educated by TV commercials. They know that the only things with any value are those they can put in a carrier bag. This is a plague area, Mr. Pearson, a plague called consumerism.
You take the idea of the domination of consumerism and you drive this through to a state of middle-class barbarism, rebellion, attempted republicanism, crowds going around wearing the St. George cross on their shirts, following different teams in different ways and behaving violently. Is this a prophetic vision? Do you think, would you describe it as that?
Yes, I think it is a vision of what might happen. I'm not saying it's going to happen, but I think there are tendencies in that direction. During the World Cup, looking at all those St. George's flags flying, a series of football matches are summoning up the kind of national energies and conviction that you only get in the time of a world war. There's something going on which suggests that people are hungry for a more disciplined society. I mean, shopping is quite a disciplined activity. There's something of the political rally, Nazi style, about, about a big shopping mall, lines of neatly aligned counters, the slogans, the expectations, the sense of, these are ceremonies of mass affirmation, where we, society, affirm in what we believe, and we believe that so-and-so washes whiter. I think there's a danger that consumerism, to keep going, may need something more violent and dramatic.
It's like what William Burroughs said about heroin. Heroin is the only product, which you sell people to rather than selling it to people. And I think that that's what Ballard believes has happened with consumerism. But as ever with Ballard, this is not to be taken as necessarily a negative statement. It's got its upside. It has its own strange potentials.
What Ballard sees as the future is boredom reaching the point where it has to be rescued by terror. It's a voyage into madness. This book seems to be preaching insanity. I mean, he's saying that essentially we've gone insane, but we've gone insane in a way that leaves us as a tranquilized, robotic state. Let's break through that. Let's start assassinating. Let's reenact the Kennedy assassinations in shopping centers.
In Kingdom Come, the main protagonist changes from being someone with whom one certainly sympathetic. He goes to find out how his father was shot and killed in this great mall. But then he actually begins to manipulate it, and he turns it into a semi-fascist state. And we don't quite know what to make of what he's doing there. It's very interestingly confusing at that point.
Various people in the book, various characters, say, fascist? Where are the ranting Führers? The reply from a psychiatrist who's concerned about all this is, we don't need a ranting Führer. Our Führers will be afternoon TV cable channel hosts. Much milder and a sort of fascism light, but it draws on the same impulses.
But in Kingdom Come, as in several of your other books you've talked about, the resolution and the solution seems to be a mixture of erotic violence. Well, you're still with that obsession, aren't you?
I'm not sure, England, say, in 2006, is all that sane and happy a place. I think at heart, there's a tremendous boredom that people swage by shopping, and there's a lack of direction, that people believe in nothing.
You think boredom is dangerous, don't you?
Boredom is dangerous, and believing in nothing is very dangerous. We all need to keep our eyes peeled for that man at the roadside with the sign saying dangerous bends ahead.
So do you see over 50 years your books, which have a great inner cohesion, sometimes use the same characters, the same names, and so on and so forth, do you see them in one sense as cautionary tales?
Yes, I think they're all cautionary tales in a way. I think they're all extrapolations from tendencies that are present. I mean, these are not long-distance prophecies of the kind that Aldous Huxley and Orwell produced in Brave New World and 1984. They're short-term prophecies, looking at the next 5 minutes, in a sense.
He's a man who's quite willing to say the unsayable. He says all the things that are most politically incorrect, most dangerous, most demented. Now, you don't know when you see the planes going into the Twin Towers or you see Diana's car crash. Journalists are straight onto Ballard as if he has somehow caused these things by getting into that wavelength so many years before and describing events before they happen.
For somebody who believes that the writer's project is to invent reality, I think Ballard has invented the reality that we live in. You cannot say of any other novelist I think, in the world, let alone England, that they have been capable of perceiving as kind of congruent entities such phenomena as global warming and environmental disaster generally, the rise of the cult of the celebrity and its implications for mass psychology, the realities of the modern world, of what technology actually did deliver to the world and to England in particular. And yes, I would stand by the assertion that he's the most significant post-war English novelist.
And to adapt to something you yourself said, do you think you've been faithful to your own obsessions? And if so, what would you say they were?
I watched my obsessions develop over 50 years as a writer, and I'm very lucky that I've been able to express those obsessions as a writer. I mean, had I decided to be a psychiatrist, I might have been able to do real damage. I'm obsessed with sort of nagging need to find the key to a sort of central mystery, which I never really identified. And I think it's probably something to do with my life in China.
The images of Ballard that stay in the mind are all from the internment camp and from Shanghai's post-imperial grandeur left to rot. These symbols of emptiness and decay and so on very much move him, and he invests them with a great deal of feeling.
When Empire of the Sun appeared, for those of us that were already steeped in the fictional oeuvre, it was like encountering this kind of primary map, whereas I suppose for other people who weren't acquainted for his fiction, it was, you know, reading a book about a boy in an internment camp during the war.
I believe all excuses. I believe all reasons. I believe all hallucinations. I believe all anger. I believe all mythologies, memories, lies, fantasies, evasions. I believe in the mystery and melancholy of a hand, in the kindness of trees, in the wisdom of light. When I was a child, I found Shanghai a complete mystery, the way in which reality could change overnight. That reality was just a stage set that could be swept aside. That all the certainties of my life, all the adult certainties that I looked up at, that gave me a sense of security, were in fact paper thin and completely treacherous. Nothing was to be trusted. And I felt an obligation to try to, a sort of almost a small boy's need to find out what on earth is going on. You know, peep through the letterhole, see what the adults are getting up to. And I knew that, you know, you couldn't trust the adults. They didn't really know what they were doing. So it was left to me to sort of have a stab at it.
Thank you very much.
And that Melvyn Bragg interview with J.G. Ballard will be available as a podcast from tomorrow. That's at itv.com/Southbank.